He sat alone in the darkness, gazing at the dying fire and seeing faces in it. The last face was so horrible and so simian that he gazed at it in amazement. It got so vivid that, with a little uneasy laugh, he felt on the table for a glass containing a little water to throw over it. His hand grasped the monkey's paw, and with a little shiver, he wiped his hand on his coat and went up to bed. At the third glass, his eyes got brighter, and he began to talk. The little family circle regarding with eager interest this visitor from distant parts as he squared his broad shoulders in the chair and spoke of the wild scenes and doughty deeds, of wars and plagues and strange peoples.
21 years of it,
said Mr. White, nodding at his wife and son.
When he went away, he was a slip of a youth in the warehouse. Now look at him.
He don't look to have taken much harm,
said Mrs. White, politely.
I'd like to go to India myself,
said the old man.
Just to look around a bit, you know.
Better where you are,
said the sergeant major, shaking his head. He put down the empty glass and, sighing softly, shook it again.
I should like to see those old temples and fakirs and jugglers,
said the old man.
What was that you started telling me the other day about a monkey's paw or something, Morris?
Nothing,
said the soldier hastily.
Leastways, nothing worth hearing.
Monkey's paw?
Said Mrs. White, curiously.
Well, it's just a bit of what you might call magic, perhaps,
said the sergeant major, offhandedly. His three listeners leaned forward eagerly. The visitor absent-mindedly put his empty glass to his lips and then set it down again. His host filled it for him.
To look at it,
said the sergeant major, fumbling in his pocket,
it's just an ordinary little paw dried to a mummy.
He took something out of his pocket and proffered it. Mrs. White drew back with a grimace, but her son, taking it, examined it curiously.
And what is there special about it? Inquired Mr. White as he took it from his son, and having examined it, placed it upon the table.
It had a spell put on it by an old fakir. It had a spell put on it by an old fakir,
said the sergeant major.
A very holy man. He wanted to show that fate ruled people's lives and that those who interfered with it did so to their sorrow. He put a spell on it so that three separate men could each have three wishes from it.
Did you give him anything for it, Father?
Inquired Mrs. White, regarding her husband closely.
A trifle,
he said, colouring slightly.
He didn't want it, but I made him take it. And he pressed me again to throw it away.
Likely,
said Herbert with pretend horror.
Why, we're going to be rich and famous and happy. Wish to be an emperor, Father, to begin with. Then you can't be henpecked.
He darted round the table, pursued by the maligned Mrs. White, armed with an antimacassar. Mr. White took the paw from his pocket and eyed it dubiously.
I don't know what to wish for, and that's a fact,
he said slowly.
It seems to me I've got all I want.
If you only cleared that house, you'd be quite happy, wouldn't you?
Said Herbert, with his hand on his shoulder.
Well, wish for £200 then. That'll just do it.
His father, smiling shamefacedly at his own credulity, held up the talisman, and his son, with a solemn face somewhat marred by a wink at his mother, sat down at the piano and struck a few impressive chords.
I wish for £200,
said the old man distinctly. A fine crash from the piano greeted the words, interrupted by a shuddering cry from the old man. His wife and son ran toward him.
It moved,
he cried, with a glance of disgust at the object as it lay on the floor.
As I wished, it twisted in my hand like a snake.
Well, I don't see the money,
said his son as he picked it up and placed it on the table.
And I bet I never shall.
It must have been your fancy, Father,
said his wife, regarding him anxiously. He shook his head.
Never mind, though, there's no harm done. It gave me a shock all the same.
They sat down by They sat down by the fire again while the two men finished their pipes. Outside, the wind was higher than ever, and the old man started nervously at the sound of a door banging upstairs. A silence, unusual and depressing, settled upon all three, which lasted until the old couple rose to retire for the night.
I expect you'll find the cash tied up in a big bag in the middle of your bed,
said Herbert as he bade them good night.
And something horrible squatting up on top of the wardrobe, watching you as you pocket your ill-gotten gains.
He sat alone in the darkness, gazing at the dying fire and seeing faces in it. The last face was so horrible and so simian that he gazed at it in amazement. It got so vivid that, with a little uneasy laugh, he felt on the table for a glass containing a little water to throw over it. His hand grasped the monkey's paw, and with a little shiver,